Right. This is roughly where it's going to sit. The idea is the front prop shaft will be the same length. In other words, I'll position the motor so this prop shaft will be the same length. A bit close there, that's fine. That's just, there used to be a big gearbox hump here, so I can modify that if needed. Mounting wise, it's got three mounts. One there, one here, and another one right on the other end there. This one here pretty much is in line with the original gearbox mount. So there's a bracket here, three bolts that are going through the chassis there already. That looks easy. This one here is right next to this big cross member mount, so that's easily doable. Now, what about the back one? Okay, so the back one is the only one that doesn't have anything really in the vicinity. It's the only one. The good thing is I'm not a pioneer here. I'm not like, there was no worry, oh, is this gonna fit? Do I have enough room? Because it's been done before. People have pioneered this well before me. So, yeah, it's lovely how it sits in there. Really tucked out of the way. Before I took all this apart, I measured the prop shafts as it was sitting with the axles drooped, took a measurement, and I also took a measurement when it was compressed. It wasn't actually that much difference. When I measured this full droop, it was 660 millimeters. So that's, I've made this the same length at the moment. Actually, the point that's actually tight is up in this corner here. It's not a big deal, could modify it a bit, and actually I think it'll be okay anyway. These Land Rover outputs from Felton, so these are designed to mate up to the Land Rover prop shafts. Land Rover prop shafts typically use a 3/8 UNF bolt, but they're not 3/8, that's M10. 3/8 is equivalent of metric is a bit more than 9.5 or something. Not a big deal. So the M10 won't go through there normally. Here's an M10. It's very tight. It won't actually go through. But that's okay. I'll just drill it out to M10. It's hardly any difference. It's just a tickle. So front prop shaft is dummied up nicely. Motor turny, diff turny. The rear one, measured it, compared it to my measurements with the Land Rover before. So we're talking 190 millimeters that this baby needs to be lengthened by. So that's something I'll send away and get professionally done. There's no friggin' way on earth that I could do that. That's definitely a professional job. You can see this prop shaft is a bit more of an angle than previously. This would have sat a bit further in. It doesn't matter. I mean, prop shafts are sort of designed to do that. While it's up there, I'm going to see if the original motor high voltage connector reaches. I sort of feel like it's going to be too short. When I was working it all out before, it's like, oh, I don't think it's going to be long enough. Let's see. That side's in. It's so close. Oh man, is it going to reach? It probably, oh. It's so close. It's annoying. I do actually have the other one for the front motor, which is really long. Like it goes from the back of the battery to the front motor. So that'll definitely be long enough, but it's going to be too long. Anyway, not everything can go perfectly. So one of the criteria really should be that the motor, the lowest point of the motor is a bit higher than the bottom point of the chassis here. Because if you're four-wheel driving and you, what do they call it? Is it turtling? When you go over a big hump so much so that it can bottom out, it's fine if it sits on the chassis, but obviously you don't want it to touch the motor. And I also want a little bit more clearance there as well.
I was also like going through, well, I probably should square these two mounts, the mount here and the mount there, which are in the same line as the motor, so the motor's straight through, but it's like why? Why do I need to do that? Bit of OCD makes me want to do that, but it doesn't matter, does it? As far as that angle goes, do I want it? Is how important is that? It's not really important. So I don't see why this needs to be at a certain angle that way or that way or even that way. It doesn't really matter. The oil pickup is on the bottom. As long as that is at the bottom, the oil pump, it's not going to matter really. I've decided this is where I want it. I've put a 3mm piece of metal here as a spacer so that this doesn't fail, and jammed it over as close as that way. And so it's tight up here. It's actually touching the floor, which doesn't matter because I'm going to have to make a different floor for this anyway. It's tight on this corner, but there is clearance, and it's something I can clearance more if I need. It's not a big deal. Also, to do that, the motor is cocked slightly that way. This is about 10 millimeters further that way than the mount at the other end. So it is slightly cocked that way. Doesn't matter, I don't think. And that helps with a bit of clearance up in here. So the rear prop shaft, looking from the rear prop shaft, it's got plenty of clearance through here. I think that's as good as it's gonna get. And I think that will be fine. So next step is to get some metal together and start welding supports. The rear one is the trickiest one. This one here that's hanging out in space a bit here. I think I'll make a cross member that comes across here, and then a plate on each end of it, and it'll bolt through the chassis with some cross tubes and then some tabs that'll come and pick that up. I want it fairly high because obviously there needs clearance for the rear prop shaft. So that's the next step, cutting and welding and stuff. So here's a fun fact. These are the original Tesla motor mounts. This is the front motor, the same for the rear motor. And they go in there and they've got a captured nut. They go through the thing in the subframe and they've got a captured nut in the subframe. But they're not tight in there. These are M12s, I think. But the hole, I mean, it doesn't matter because it's a crush tube and it will hold onto that, so it's not going to wobble about. But also, I don't have the nuts for these because they're in the subframe. I can probably find some, but these are big Tesla suspension bolts that hold the arms on, and they're actually a better fit. And they, when in the suspension, they have a lovely nut that comes with them. They're both definitely going to be strong enough. They're both 10.9 grade. Totally over engineering. They obviously don't need a bolt this big because Tesla have worked out they only need an M12. But I'm going to use these because I can use the nut and, you know, bigger is better. The motor mounts have been tacked into place. I don't want to fully weld them yet until I, you know, want to make sure that they're exactly how I want. I'll probably gusset this across here, maybe even add a bit of a gusset there and on the side, because why not? That'll give it a lot more strength. The side there, some 5mm angle. And then for the rear one, which is the trickiest one, I've put this cross member in. This is at an angle. One consideration, obviously, is the prop shaft comes out here, back to the diff front, and you can see, you know, how they've had to angle that to clear the prop shaft. So that's well out of the way of the prop shaft, so it's high on this end. This end, I've angled it down to the top of the chassis, and then some 5mm plates to come out right next to the motor mount. gate, so you can get it out easy, but it's not loose in there. All right, so I am happy enough with the motor mounts now. It's got plenty of clearance underneath. So yeah, that's all pretty good. Yeah, so I still have to weld them properly and get rid of all the excess metal and horrible looking stuff. But I'm going to send photos to the engineer first, just so that's cool. I mean, the battery's in, the motor's pretty much mounted. I've got to finish off those mounts, but most of the work's done. Just realised that exactly a week ago, last Monday, I drove this car with the diesel engine in it onto the hoist. So it's only been a week and I've got the motor and the battery in. Now I know that that's where the motor's going to be. I'll take a measurement at the back and send the rear prop shaft away to get lengthened, because then they can do that while I'm doing all the other stuff.
Motor mounts are all done, welded up and painted. Got the front mount, which is obviously touches to the original cross member. The side mount, which uses the same holes, the same three holes. Transmission used to mount on this side too, except I've upped them to M10 rather than M8. And then the new rear cross member that gets the rear motor mount, they're going to be M10 as well. But before I put them all in, I'm going to have to put some cross tubes in. So this one's probably okay because it's right on the edge of the chassis. These ones are okay. This one, and this one, because they're in the middle of the chassis rail, it'll, you'll tighten it up and it'll crush the chassis together. So I need to weld in a cross tube, just a tube that goes across and gives it strength, basically. I need to find some cross tube from somewhere.
Check out this sweet baby I just got from the dump. So the best place to get metal is the metal recycling spot at the dump. That looks about the right size. We could cut this baby open. That doesn't look too bad, actually.
Hey, it's a good diameter. Price is right. It's pretty good as far as recycling go, this whole project, because obviously we're using a wrecked Tesla, so you don't need to buy any new parts for most things. There are some new parts, obviously. All these steel components are bits I had lying around. It's quite ironic, actually. This piece was part of an engine stand that I don't need. And this chair wasn't going to be used for anything anymore.
Lovely and tight. So I've camfered the hole and the tube the other way so that there's a gap in there so I can weld into that and then grind it flush. So first little pink toddler seat tube is welded in. So when you tighten this up, it's not just going to push the chassis rail together, it'll have a bit more strength to him. These are the original holes for the transmission and I'm just putting a crush tube in this one and thinking, well, don't need them on these. But doesn't look like I actually needed it on that one either. So you can see, I thought, oh, well, they just haven't bothered putting them in, but they sort of have, and it's not a crushed tube, it's more just bits of flat plate. You can see them in there, each side of them. So that's why they haven't had to put a crushed tube in there, because they've already got something in there. So that's cool. I mean, now I've drilled this hole now, so I might as well put the crushed tube in. But I didn't really need to in the end. Cross tube arrows have all been cleaned up. And just got to give them a bit of paint, a bit of zinc paint. So I'm ready to put the motor back up in here. The big HVAC unit's got to go here. And this bit is in the way. So I've sort of got to cut that. There's no other way around it, really. But you can see here, it's gonna leave all this open with no strength there. It's a chassis based vehicle, obviously, so the chassis is what does all the important stuff, but the body would do something as well, and I don't really want to just leave this unsupported. I mean, it does mount on the chassis here and it's strong and at the back here. Still though, I'm not comfortable with just cutting that out and not bracing it. So I've made up a strengthening bar brace thing. So I worked out where it had to sit when I had the motor sitting in there. So this sits just above the motor and I've got it bolting through the seat squab here. So yeah, and that'll hopefully, well, it definitely will provide strength across. Nice and strong. It's got three mounts either side and comes up and bolts into the seat. Cut the middle bit out. That's done. And cutting it out, like, there was no tension or anything in it, so I don't think it offers much support. Although it makes the end of this, having this brace will definitely make the end of this stronger, so that's all right. There we go, sitting in there. Why I had to cut that middle bit out, it just makes it sit down more. I need to put the motor up in there just to see the clearances in there, but I'm actually quite happy with that. The main thing, the refrigerant lines come to a good spot in the firewall to put them through there. And I'll have to put an air duct, probably just here or something, an air inlet. I need to mount the motor and do all that before I can fiddle around with this anymore. So yeah, I'm gonna get the motor mounted in here, which is exciting. So much easier putting this in than even just the transmission of the Land Rover, which was a nightmare. Check it out, motor is in. Looks good up in there. Very happy with how the mounts turned out. Enough clearance everywhere, just. Front prop shaft is on. I had to find some suitable M10 high tensile bolts. It's good having the Torx or an Allen head key because it can be hard to get up in around the uni. You got to get in a certain spot. So, rear prop shaft. I took it into, was it M&A Engineering in Mitchell in Canberra, who do that sort of stuff all the time to extend it by 184 millimetres. And a week later, they came back and here it is. Looks really good, actually. Not the cheapest thing. This cost me $780 to get done. Bit of expense there, but this, like, there's no way I could do this. Like, this is, you have to get this perfectly centre. So I'm going to put that up in and, well, hopefully it's the right length. Well, would you look at that? It even fits. Nice. So that's done. That is done. I mean, the battery's in, the motor's in. I need to put the high voltage cable across. I need to organise lengthening that. The thing is, if I'd done it the easy way, which I never do, which is also the more expensive way, and just bought an aftermarket controller, which you can get for the Model 3, I could plug that in and drive this car. It's like, that's the conversion. The battery and the motor are connected. I'd have to obviously connect that and hook up the logic for the controller. That would be it. Other than, you know, I mean, I've already done the power steering. I haven't done the brake booster yet. Theoretically, this would be a drivable unit. How funny would that be, driving around without anything in the old engine bay? We've made awesome progress there. So the thing is with this project, and I knew it was going to be the case, the devil's in the detail. So the time spent now is, you know, mounting the HVAC, creating a new floor around the HVAC, ducting all these. Wiring harness sort of just needs to be put in and routed somehow. I've got to mount this in the old engine bay. We've sort of ticked off the two big ticket items there, the battery and the motor. Yeah, it's exciting. So before I forget about it, I'm going to put the transmission breather, the reduction gear breather in. It's a little breather I've made up. That's the only spot that you can get water in the gear train of the Tesla. So I've changed a little just basic breather system. If you're doing a creek crossing, that could get water in it. So I'm doing this is the Land Rover technique. You just put a breather to a higher spot, and most of them sort of went to the top of the firewall here on the other side. So I've got some 13 mil hose, and I'll route that up to the front of the firewall. Oh, comfy, yes.